Welcome back. We are going to draw skulls today from the front and the side view. What we're trying to end up with is a drawing that looks like this, with the side view on one side and the front view on the other. So please leave enough space on your paper when you do the side view to put the front view alongside it. Okay, we're going to take a look at our reference, which is from Paul Richet's Anatomy for Artists book, a French classic from the 19th century. So let me just open that for you. And this has not only the skull, but also shows you the relationship between the skull and the features. And we are going to begin by drawing the cranium. We're starting with a half circle. And another half circle with a space in the middle. This space is about 20% of the overall width of the half circle. And I just want to remind everybody, definition of a half circle is the radius, the vertical radius is the same as the horizontal radius. I have a lot of students who draw half circles like this or like this. These are not half circles because the radius, vertical and horizontal radius, are very different, okay? So we're trying to be fairly precise here. We want to have about 20% wider than it is tall.
Why don't you draw one big circle?
Because there's a
spot. It's not an ellipse. It's a racetrack shape. So it has, we're going to think of it as a pair of half circles. So we're going to place the brow ridge just under this center line. The brow ridge is a protrusion. It's under your eyebrows. If you touch your face, you can feel a slight bulge of bone there. If your ancestors are Neanderthals, you're going to have a much larger protrusion there. And that is, as I'm sure you know, it's pretty well documented that some of us do have Neanderthal ancestry. That's not a, it's not a put down. Yeah, we shouldn't use it as a slur. Neanderthal is a. They're just as good as you and me. I don't know. Okay, so the bottom of the nose is going to line up with the bottom of the cranium. And we're going to draw the line of the face as a line that goes straight down. And we're going to mark the center of the brow ridge, which is just below the center of the cranium here. And the bottom half of the face is going to be the same distance as, we're going to call this the top half of the face, and this is the bottom half, and they're going to be the same size. So make sure this size and this size are the same. And remember to measure something with your pencil. You put the pencil point at the top of the thing you're trying to measure, and you slide your finger until it's at the bottom, like this. And then you check like that, and you can see these are the same. It's a very crude measuring method, but it works. And you can also use that to measure things that are on the other side of the room, as long as you are careful to close one eye and keep your arm fully extended. Slide your thumb up and down like that. And as long as your arm is fully extended, you can measure things that are far away. In case you're wondering, your arm has to be fully extended because that keeps it at a constant distance from your eye. If your elbow is bent, then your hand is going to be at a variable distance from your eye. Okay, so we check to make sure these are the same. And if we double this one more time, we don't end up at the top of the head. We end up at the hairline, which is about there. But the skull's not going to have hair, so it's not really a big deal. Okay, we're going to put the ear hole near the bottom of this box, and not all the way at the bottom, and not exactly centered. We're going to put it just a little bit closer to the back of the box. And this is a pretty accurate representation of the cranium until we get to the back of the head. I'm going to show you what it looks like to... I drafted the forms that I teach over this skull, and you can see pretty consistently you're going to find two things that come out past it. One is the occipital bone, which is like the back of the skull, and the other is the mastoid process. So this is the form of the occipital. So we're going to extend this out here, and I'll zoom out a little so you can see the labels. Here's the occipital, and here's the mastoid process right behind the ear hole. This is a little more complicated than my older methods, but it's a little more accurate too. So, okay, so double check, make sure these distances are the same, and then we're going to go up about 12 degrees like that for the bottom of the jaw. And then we're going to go to the right in front of the ear hole, and we're going to go forward about 12 degrees. And you're going to end up with the angle of the jaw about here. Okay. Right under the brow ridge, I know I've already asked you to do this, but if you put a finger under your brow ridge into that little indentation, you can see under your finger. So that's always going to tell you, first of all, there's an indentation right here, and that indentation is going to be right above eye level. So eye level is going to be here. And if you do everything right, what happens is your eye level ends up being centered on the overall head. So I'm going to check that measurement, and that's where you want to be for your eye level. Because this is a skull and not a living person, the nose ends right after that indentation. And then to represent the bottom of the nose, we just have this little upward movement right there. Here's the muzzle form. I know I've talked about that before. It's like the muzzle of a dog, only on humans, it's much flatter. So everyone's familiar with the word muzzle from dogs. That's a dog muzzle. This is a human muzzle. Much shallower form. Here's the curve of the chin. And if you want to make it fancy, you can copy some of the things that you see in Richet's diagram, but that's not very essential. So you can see that the eye socket fits neatly in the edge of this circle that we used, and it's foreshortened. In fact, it's typically more foreshortened than we see in Richet's diagram. This is a sculpture of a skull that's a little more typical foreshortening. So that's the one I'm going to use for my drawing. And it's going to be centered around this eye level, and it's going to pretty much hug this curve. So we're going to end up with something like that. Remember, we found eye level first, so the eye socket, the top of the eye socket is right under the brow ridge, and then the bottom of the eye socket is going to be equidistant as you go as far down below eye level as you went above eye level. You'll notice that the cheekbone is going to extend just a little out past this curve. It's pretty much under the eye socket, but it's set back just a little bit. So you can see in this diagram also. So, and the cheekbone bottoms out at around the bottom of the nose opening, and it's just a little shorter than the bottom of the cranium. And the cheekbone, we're going to draw it back. It's going to end right above the ear hole. And the top of the cheekbone branches off behind the eye socket into the zygomatic process. It's important to memorize these forms because when you're drawing, you're going to do a much better drawing if you know what to expect than if you do not know what to expect. These forms are really usually not very relevant to artists because we don't see them on living people, but we can sketch them in anyway. Now, here's a proportion thing that a lot of people get wrong, so pay attention. This is the bottom half of the face. The muzzle form occupies the top two-thirds, and the teeth break right across the center of the muzzle form. So that's going to be, they're going to end up being a third of the way down. And because the shape of the dental arch, skulls always look happy. And if you're interested in drawing teeth, notice that the molars are really squarish and large, and they run all the way back behind the blade of the jawbone. And then as we get towards the front, the teeth get smaller, and they also are foreshortened. So they overlap each other and occupy much less space in the drawing. I'm not counting teeth. I'm not trying to get this exactly right. People have different numbers of teeth. Well, if you've had, a lot of people have had a lot of teeth pulled to make room in their mouths. And that's about it. Pretty simple, right? So the goal now is to draw the front view, and we're trying to align everything that we just did with the side view. So what I mean is, because we only need to memorize the proportions once. If we've memorized them from the side, they're going to apply to the front. So carefully extend with horizontal lines where you're going to draw this head. You can extend the eye level, making sure it stays exactly in the middle. We can extend the bottom of the cranium and the line between the teeth. And everything else we can kind of improvise. So the basic form that we want to start with for the front view is a circle. And the cranium from the front is basically round. So this is not a racetrack. This is just a regular old circle. And we're going to try to place it between these lines like that. Now the way the eyes are going to fall on this line, and the way we're going to think about the eyes is sort of like a pair of aviator sunglasses. So we're going to draw them. There's the top of the eyes, there's the bottom of the eyes, and they sort of droop a little towards the outside corners like sunglasses do. Sort of like this and like this. And now on a living person, the space between the eyes is about as big as one eye. But you'll notice that on the skull, the space between the eyes is smaller than an eye socket because eye sockets are obviously bigger than eyes.
Wait, I'm really lost. The right eye, it looks like the top is bigger, and on the bottom, left eye, it looks like the bottom is going out further.
Well, I'm not, I must have drawn it wrong. They should be the
same.
They should be the same.
So they kind of get a little bit like, they show down.
Yeah, they kind of droop towards the outside like that. They should be the same. The zygomatic is very thin from the front. And I know this is something we've done before, but if you press back on the outside corner of your eye, you're going to feel that sharp bone right outside the corner of your eye.
Mr. Ellie, can you
And the eye, the nose hole is going to be like a sort of an upside down heart that is between these eye sockets. And the bottom of it is going to just hit this line.
Where's the top of it?
The top ends below the center of the eye sockets. So remember, this is our eye line. The top of the nose hole should end below that. And there's a slight flattening of the skull to the left and the right of the zygomatic. So it's not a perfect circle form. And that flattening is a space that accommodates your muscle, the muscles you chew with. The masseter, yeah. And you can, if you press on your temples and right above your cheekbone, open and close your mouth, you can feel that muscle. It attaches up here, goes under the cheekbone and to the jaw. Gorillas, as you probably know, have to chew a lot more than we do, and that's why they have giant masseter muscles that actually attach all the way on those ridges on the top of their skulls. Ours attach on our temples. Okay, so the zygomatic comes out into the cheekbone. Notice that the cheekbone is not as wide as the cranium. See, the cranium comes out to here. Cheekbone is set in a little bit narrower than the cranium was. And the cranium disappears behind the cheekbone on the left and the right. And the cheekbone, as you can see from the first drawing we did, it comes down almost to the bottom of the cranium, but not quite. And for the width of the cheekbone, this is important, so pay attention. If you go from the center of the eye socket down, that's about how wide what we call the dental arch is. I'm going to show you on this one, too, so you can see what I'm talking about. So the dental arch is approximately as wide as the space between the pupils of the eyes. So that's this form. It comes down like that and ends with the curve of the skull's smile. And this curve should bottom out right on this line. Notice that the smile goes up above that line and back, bottoms out right there. Okay, notice that the zygomatic is about as wide as the jaw. You see that? So if we come down from the zygomatic, that gives us about how wide the jaw needs to be. And we know where the angle of the jaw is because it hits. We can carry that over. So notice this angle just comes in a little bit to here, and then it's relatively steep to here. So this is almost vertical, and then it's a more of a sharp change from here to here. Now, that used to confuse me. These angles are exactly the same. They're both 12 to 15 degrees here and here. Now we have two angles that are really different. And the reason for that is, again, because of foreshortening. From the side, the jaw looks like this with two identical angles. And when we rotate that towards us, you see what happens to the upper part of the jaw. It becomes almost vertical, but as the bottom angle foreshortens, it gets much, much bigger. So that's what we're observing here, is the effects of foreshortening on those two angles. And we're going to draw teeth, but don't get hung up on teeth. I'm never going to make you draw a smiling person in this class. Know that the front teeth are obviously relatively wide, and that the teeth get smaller as they go back. And now, because the molars are foreshortened and overlapping each other, we don't see as much of them. And I might have come down a little too far in the nose hole. It's really, the hole ends slightly higher than the, this line represents the bone at the bottom of the nose, so might be a little more like that. And if you're all set with your proportions, you can do a little bit of shading on this. But again, the superficial things that we're shading are not what you need to know in order to do a portrait of a living person. So I really want you to get in the habit of, if you get the proportions right in one drawing, then you should precisely carry them across so you get them right, correct in the second drawing as well. You don't have to reinvent the wheel every time. So those are our finished skulls. And I think I'm going to end this video now, but I'll come around and look at your work in a second.